I've had choices since the day that I was born. There were voices.
Welcome back to the Laura Ingraham Show, your healthy radio addiction. The retirement of Justice Anthony Kennedy has sent the left into a tailspin, which is really interesting since while he was regarded as a swing justice, he's voted with a conservative majority in a whole string of recent cases. And so now Washington is abuzz. Everybody is wondering who is going to be nominated to replace Justice Kennedy and how is that nominee going to fare in the U.S. Senate. And to help us think through some of those questions, we are joined now by Ken Klukowski, Senior Counsel at the American Civil Rights Union. Ken, thanks for being on the program.
John, thanks for having me, and happy belated 4th of July.
Yes, and happy Independence Day to you. Ken, there are various people who are putting out alleged short lists of possible nominees. There was an original list of, I think, 25 that President Trump put out some time ago. The Wall Street Journal is now reporting that there are only three contenders, Brett Kavanaugh, Raymond Kethledge, and Amy Coney Barrett. What's your view of this? Do we actually know what the so-called short list is?
We do, John, and that is that the president took a good hard look at six judges, including those three that you mentioned, who are the three that are right up at the top, as well as judges Amul Thapar, Tom Hardiman, and also Joan Larson, and then also had a conversation with Senator Mike Lee, but it does not appear. That was something of anything of a formal interview. Senator Lee is the one that Senator Ted Cruz is aggressively advocating for the Supreme Court. But whether Senator Lee is on or not, let's go ahead and count him in. Those seven out of the 25 are the seven that are under active consideration as the president gets ready to make his final choice. A choice, let me add, that will absolutely define his presidency. The prospects, given that for 21% of voters on Election Day 2016, the U.S. Supreme Court was their number one issue. Those voters broke for the president by a 57-41 split. That makes it a plus 16 margin for the president, which is an overwhelming issue when it comes to presidential elections. The president, the stakes could not be higher for him going into 2020, because whatever the true colors are of the justice he picks, those true colors will be clear by November of 2020. So whether he wants to absolutely supercharge his base in a way that no president could hope to get above, or whether he wants to have an outright revolt among the base, the stakes could not be higher to make sure that he gets a rock-ribbed, consistent constitutional conservative in this seat at the Supreme Court.
Ken, my impression is that however you define the list, you know, and you think it's down to seven, you're probably right about that. It's a very conservative bunch, isn't it? I mean, are there any possible David Souters on the list as far as you can see?
There's no possibility of a David Souter on the list. I should say I know many people on this list personally. In fact, I know a majority of the people on the list. Some of them I actually know reasonably well. There's certainly no David Souters on the court, but the danger for the president is not a closet liberal, because most certainly those have been kicked off. The danger for the president is to appoint someone who is someone who votes conservative half the time, but then votes liberal half the time. You know, it's Kennedy went the right way, for example, on the travel ban case. But he goes the wrong way on abortion. He goes the wrong way on racial preferences. He goes the wrong way on some issues that are of extreme importance to the base. And also, not only that, but the other danger to the president, and I'm saying this as someone who's looking out both for the country and for the president, I want the president to be well served, is that he also, the president also would not want another Chief Justice John Roberts. And I say that with all due respect to the Chief Justice, but his vote saving Obamacare in 2012 was something that changed the course of the country and of our entire national politics and our entire national policy. So there's the solution for, in terms of the people who voted for the president because of the Supreme Court, they're not looking for just a Republican justice. They're looking for a consistent, reliable, conservative justice, someone like Neil Gorsuch. And the vetting cannot be too rigorous in terms of making sure that that is what you're getting and what you're putting on the U.S. Supreme Court.
So, Ken, having said all that, have you got a favorite out of the remaining contenders?
I think there are pros and cons for different ones. It's because I also sometimes cover aspects of this situation journalistically. And I'm affiliated with a couple organizations that are not making an endorsement for one candidate over the other. I keep any personal preferences in those terms to myself. I do think that there are different points that especially recommend one candidate versus another on different issues. I mean, overall, it's a very well-qualified list. But again, when you're raising the bar, and this is so challenging, and I want to commend those who have helped advise the president, certainly Leonard Leo, who's taken a leave of absence from the Federalist Society to be able to advise the White House, and also White House Counsel Don McGahn. I mean, these men are and all the networks around them, and the Federalist Society, and the Heritage Foundation. I mean, they're passionate about these things. You know, you've already got the bar to where, again, you're avoiding having another David Souter. But to raise the bar enough where you're screening out not just any potential suitors, but any Kennedys, or for that matter, again, trying not to have another center-right type conservative who's not a consistent conservative, like Chief Justice John Roberts. I mean, you're getting into real demanding territory there. And so you really have to be looking for indications of someone who is willing to take the fire, go the extra mile, no apologies, no trimming of sails. Someone who says, my God-given responsibility is to safeguard the Republic by adhering to the original public meaning of the Constitution. I don't care what the polls say. I don't care if it means I don't get invited to cocktail parties. I don't care if 1,000 newspapers take out op-eds calling me an idiot and screaming at me and cursing me. It doesn't matter. I answer to a higher calling, and this is why I have a lifetime tenure, so that I can resist all of those pressures and be 100% committed to the Constitution and rule of law. And that is a very, very rare find, to find someone with that kind of heart and character and conviction, but also the kind of incredible intellect that you need on the Supreme Court. Someone, again, like Neil Gorsuch, unbelievably brilliant, but coupled with just this absolute commitment to principle, it's an extremely rare find. And so I would, of course, urge the president and those around him, sir, make sure you get this one right. Both for the sake of what you want to achieve, as I know the president's committed to these things, but also because once this choice is made, it's not like a bad cabinet pick that you can get rid of. Once you make this pick, that pick's going to be there for 30 or 40 years. And whether or not we get this right, whether or not the president gets this right, I believe will be clear to the voters in November of 2020. So every care must be taken to get this right.
We're talking with Ken Klukowski of the American Civil Rights Union. Ken, let's get specific about some of these possible nominees. Brett Kavanaugh is widely regarded as one of the front runners. Do you see him as being in that category of solid, rock-ribbed conservatives?
Well, I'll tell you, there are a lot of people who praise and support Judge Kavanaugh. He also has his critics, or at least his questioners, but you know, you can say that about anyone. You could have said that about Neil Gorsuch, for that matter, a couple years ago. Judge Kavanaugh has had very strong decisions on immigration issues, obviously a big priority for the president. Also, regarding the separation of powers, I think one standout case for him was one regarding that went to the Supreme Court in what's called the Free Enterprise Fund case back in 2010 regarding the constitutionality of a financial oversight board created by the Sarbanes-Oxley law about 15 years ago. When it went through his court, the U.S. Court of Appeals for the D.C. Circuit, where they upheld it, he dissented. And he went back and said that he believes the Supreme Court should overrule a 1935 case, Humphrey's Executor. This is the case where the Supreme Court, in its massive move to the left, and again, this is where we get to the importance of the Supreme Court, because that was a bad case 80 years ago that we've been stuck with as a country for 8 decades now. Humphrey's Executor is where the court overruled prior precedent and said that it's okay under the Constitution to have some of the people the president appoints to not be removable at will, to have some length of tenure, to be semi-independent from him. There were Supreme Court cases on the book that says, look, the president's power to appoint someone always includes the power to fire the incumbent so that he can appoint someone new. And that's how you maintain democratic accountability, that these bureaucrats answer to the president answers to the people. So it's all about empowering the people. Under the Constitution, Humphrey's Executor went the wrong way in 1935, and is kind of one of the foundation cases that gave us the swamp that we've lived with for decades now. Kavanaugh said he would overrule Humphrey's Executor. So, I mean, that a decision like that is a really huge move that shows some serious courage. But again, of course, that's just one issue out of a number. I'm just kind of picking highlights here.
Now, one thing about Kavanaugh is he does have quite a bit of appellate experience. And of course, that also means appellate record in terms of writing opinions for the other side to shoot at. Probably the woman who has gotten the most attention so far in the process has been Amy Coney Barrett, law professor who's only been on the bench for under a year. Is that a problem in your view, that lack of a real track record as an appellate judge?
Well, the question is, how do you determine what a person's philosophy is? Judicial record is the single biggest and best indicator of that. It's not the only one, though, because, again, let's look, for example, at Senator Mike Lee. Mike Lee has never been a judge, but I would say that Mike Lee probably has the most crystal clear record of any of these, of anyone on the list, because Lee, as an elected senator, goes out and gives half-hour and hour-long speeches about constitutional issues, takes very conservative positions, and takes all the fire on something like that. And I think that's why Senator Ted Cruz said he would support Mike Lee. So you have, in the case of Lee, someone who has a record that's not a judicial record, but it is 100% rock-ribbed conservative across the board on economic issues, social issues, national security issues. I mean, a hardcore constitutional conservative. So you can look for those same sort of things with Judge Barrett, because she was, for roughly a decade, she was a law professor at one of the top law schools in the country, the University of Notre Dame, clerked for Scalia, and of course now is on the Seventh Circuit. Having clerked on the Court of Appeals, I'll say that, you know, most federal appeals are boring. They're not newsworthy. Most of them are unanimous. They turn on technical issues. They don't really reveal something about the judge, because again, most federal appellate judges will be unanimous in how they decide most appeals. Maybe a half dozen times a year, you get an issue that might turn on philosophical differences on how you interpret the Constitution or how you read the law. And maybe every 3 or 5 years, you get a big controversial case. And the reality is that you can't build a judicial record on those sorts of issues without just having enough time on the bench to have gotten the luck of the draw, where you randomly pull a number of those major cases that really show what you're made of. So when you're looking at an instance like that, that's when you're looking at other indications for judicial philosophy. And everything else about Judge Barrett's life as a professor, as a person, shows her to be a person of deep principle, passionate principle, deep personal faith. In fact, she was attacked by some Senate Democrats for being such a devout Roman Catholic, for example. And so I think, in violation of the Constitution, by the way, which doesn't allow the Senate to look at someone's religion when determining their fitness for office, you look at all that to get a sense of what a person's judicial philosophy is. And those who know Judge Barrett best in that regard are huge fans of her and say that they would bet everything on her. So she certainly has a number of people who have a lot of stake who line up for her big time.
Yeah, Ken, she, there's no question she's a committed practicing Catholic, which the Democrats have attacked her for. One sign of that, which I just love, is that she has seven children. You know,
that's right.
That's rare for people who are in the kind of position, for women who are in the kind of position that she is.
And let me add to that, John, that I'll tell you, as someone who's taught law school, you know, when you're a law professor for a number of years, I mean, all sorts of stuff come up in class where you discuss it in front of, you know, however big your class is, 30, 50, 70 students, where some of the hottest issues of the day, you know, whether it's abortion, same-sex marriage, Obamacare, immigration, I mean, all of those things, no matter what class you're teaching, even if it's like civil procedure or contracts, you know, you'll get a student who raises the hand, hey, professor, what do you think about? And then they talk and then they ask about the big case that's in the news. And so it is very common for a law professor to just take 10 minutes of their own class to pontificate on what the Constitution means. The fact that people who have been around her so close at Notre Dame says, oh, yeah, she is a serious conservative, that's actually a very good place where you can extract a person's judicial philosophy.
All right, Ken Klukowski, thanks for being with us. We're going to go to a break. We'll be right back.
The Laura Ingraham Show.